Let's open our Bibles to 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1, we want to read verse 14 here. He says, "That good thing which was committed to you, keep by the Holy Spirit who dwells in us." And we read about the Holy Spirit in the Bible, and then you hear people talk about the Holy Spirit, and there's a lot of confusion about Him. There doesn't seem to be a lot of confusion about the Father, or a lot of confusion about the Son, although there is some on each of those out there. But when it comes to the subject of the Holy Spirit, there are people who present all kinds of ideas and thoughts about who He is and what He does and how He does it. You have things like you find among Pentecostal and charismatic people, and now it seems many others, that believe the Holy Spirit personally, directly indwells an individual and reveals things to them, actually speaks to them, gives them a particular message, usually a personal message, and or that the Holy Spirit empowers them to perform miracles in the modern day. There are some who believe that the Spirit is an impersonal force. Jehovah's Witnesses believe the Holy Spirit's just like similar to gravity, but in the spiritual realm, just a force that is out there, not a person, not an individual being, if you will. And then there are brethren who believe in a personal indwelling of the Holy Spirit, but there's no message, there's no miracle that is performed, but somehow the Holy Spirit personally, literally dwells within your body. And the thing that's always tripped me up about that is that then does away with the uniqueness of the incarnation of the Son of God. Because one of the things that is so amazing about Jesus of Nazareth was that He was both God and man. And in that, He was unique. If the Holy Spirit dwells in all Christians, literally, bodily, then there are many incarnations of the divine in human form. And so what we want to do is examine the Word of God and see what is it that it says about the Holy Spirit. Because those confusions do abound in the world around us, let's be clear that I do believe the Holy Spirit dwells in a Christian. The Bible most definitely teaches that. But it's not an issue of dwelling in the Christian versus not dwelling in the Christian. The question is, what manner, what means that this is accomplished? What is it that the Bible says about the Spirit dwelling in us? And we want to be reminded that the Bible is our only source of information. We cannot go by our feelings, we can't go by our experiences, and we can't go by what Aunt Ethel says about her neighbor's brother who lives in West Virginia, no offense, Bonnie. You can't go by what somebody says happened somewhere else. Can't go by even on what you feel like or your own personal experience in life. Because my feelings and your feelings are different. Your experiences and my experiences are different. Those things do not establish truth. What establishes truth is the Word of God. And so we need to look to the Word of God and see what it tells us about the nature and the work of the Holy Spirit. We begin by thinking about who is the Holy Spirit. If you go to John chapter 16 with me. John chapter 16, this is Jesus talking to His disciples the night of His betrayal. And we want to notice what He says to them here in John 16 verses 13 down through 15. It says, "However, when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you into all truth, for He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak, and He will tell you things to come. So when you read about the Holy Spirit here in verse 13, he talks about, first of all, that the Holy Spirit is a he. Sometimes you'll hear people refer to the Holy Spirit as it. The Holy Spirit's not an it. Like, this building is an it. Computer's an it. A car is an it. The Holy Spirit is he. Personal pronoun. So an individual being. And it says concerning him that he will guide you into all truth. Why? Because he's going to hear something and then he's going to speak something. Those are referring to characteristics of an individual being, a person, if you will. I know not a person like you and I, but a person or an individual intelligent being. So he hears, he speaks. He goes on to talk about in verse 14, he will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. So he is an active being, a person, if you will. If you notice Luke chapter 12, verse 12. And he also makes mention of this. Luke 12, verse 12. For the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. So the Holy Spirit teaches. In Acts 16, verse 6, it talked about the Holy Spirit forbidding certain things. So there's commands that come in that teaching, his speaking, his declaration. And one more I would like us to look at in Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30, where it tells us that the Holy Spirit has emotions, if you will. Ephesians 4, verse 30, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. So there are behaviors or attitudes that we can have that we grieve the Holy Spirit, that we make the Holy Spirit sad. When we live unrighteously, we grieve the Holy Spirit. When we mistreat one another, we grieve the Holy Spirit. But the point is that all these things are describing the Holy Spirit not as an impersonal force, not as an it, if you will, but a he, an individual, a being, if you will. Then again, we want to notice the Holy Spirit is divine. In Acts chapter 5, we read here the account of Ananias and Sapphira, how they lied about what they had given, and both of them end up being struck dead. But when Peter confronts Ananias in Acts 5, verse 3, he addressed him and said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and keep back part of the price of the land for yourself? While it remained, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not in your own control? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. So first of all, he said, why have you lied to the Holy Spirit? Then he comes back and says that you've not lied to men, but you've lied to God. And so he's equating the Holy Spirit with God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, let's notice that the Holy Spirit, with that nature of God, that nature of divinity, possesses the qualities and characteristics of divinity. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, let's notice verses 10 and 11. He says, but God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. So the Spirit searches all things. He knows the mind of God. He knows all things pertaining to God. So he is omniscient. He's all-knowing. That's a quality or characteristic only of God. And then in Matthew chapter 12, verse 28. Where Jesus is talking about the work that is being performed, the miracles that are being done. He says in Matthew 12, verse 28, but if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. So the Holy Spirit has miraculous powers. When you get further into the New Testament, you can read about the Holy Spirit enduing men with power that they may perform miracles. Casting out demons, making the lame to walk, raising the dead. That's omnipotence or all power. So the Holy Spirit, the Bible tells us, is God or has the nature of God. Now, some people really struggle understanding this idea of the nature of God, the Father being God, the Son being God, the Holy Spirit being God. How could three beings be God if there's only one God? Let's look at that for a minute in 2 Corinthians chapter 13. 2 Corinthians 13, let's notice verse 14 here. For it says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. So he mentions Jesus, the Son, God the Father, and the Holy Spirit. Three individual beings. And when you study in the New Testament, you recognize that the Father is not the Holy Spirit. In John 14, let's go back there and notice in John 14, we'll also jump over to John 16 in just a moment. But John 14, verse 16 says that I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. So praying to the Father, who would give a helper. So the Holy Spirit and the Father are two different beings. And then in chapter 16, verse 14, says, he will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. Again, the Son, one being, the Holy Spirit, a different being. And then if you would also notice in John chapter 8, we're going to skip over to John chapter 8. And notice what Jesus says relative to himself and the Father. We're just trying to establish, the Bible's very clear, there are three distinct beings in the Godhead or that possess Godhood. In John chapter 8, verse 17, Jesus said, it is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one who bears witness of myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness of me. So you have to have two to testify, to establish the truth. He says, I'm one, the Father's other, the other. So the Father and the Son are two different, distinct beings. Now again, there are people who struggle with this, but perhaps this illustration will help a little bit. Probably the best that I've seen in explaining it. You take an egg, and you have three essential parts to that egg. You got the shell, it's egg. You got the yolk, you got the white, but they're all egg. And nobody would question that. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are all God. There's one God, one nature of God, but three distinct beings that possess that nature. Or you might think of it this way. There are billions of people on this planet, and we're all human. We have the nature of humanity. That nature of humanity is distinct from being a giraffe, or a gorilla, or an elephant, or a shark, or a whale, or any other creature. It's a distinct, there's only one nature of humanity. There's not two, there's not three, there's not five natures of humanity. And for those of you who have been exposed to evolution, which we all have, you know, they've got that chart usually. There's some type of knuckle-dragging, humanoid-looking thing, and then it stands a little more upright, and a little more upright, and a little more upright, and then they say we got modern man, and so they say all those things are different stages of human development. It's a lie. There's one nature, always has been one nature, of humanity. But billions of us possess that nature. There's one nature of God that's possessed by three beings, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So that's who the Holy Spirit is and the nature of the Holy Spirit. Let's think now about the Holy Spirit dwelling in Christians. And we'll begin by looking actually at the Father and his relationship to the child of God. If we go to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4, verse 12 beginning. The Bible tells us that the Christian dwells in the Father, and the Father dwells in the Christian. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. God is in us, and we are in God. And most people don't have a great challenge understanding that. Back in chapter 3, verse 24, it says, "Now he who keeps his commandments abides in him, and he in him." So we recognize that the way we abide in the Father, the way the Father abides in us, is when we keep his commandments, when we obey his will, when we follow the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am not aware of anyone who believes that God the Father literally, personally indwells a Christian. I don't know anyone who believes that. If you know someone, you know, you'll inform me about that, I guess, after word. But I've never heard anybody claim God the Father dwells in someone, either a miraculous or a non-miraculous sense. They understand what the Bible teaches. You keep his commandments, you're in him, and he is in you. And then again, the Bible tells us that the Son dwells in us, and we dwell in him. If you go to John chapter 15. John chapter 15, Jesus in this passage is talking about the vine and the branches. And let's just notice how he describes it here. John chapter 15, verse 1. "I am the vine," or the true vine, "and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I'm the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you." And we'll pause right there. Do you see him talking about you abide in me and I abide in you? There's that relationship between Christ, who is the vine, and his disciples, who are the branches. The abiding in. I abide in you and you abide in me. And notice how he switches it up. In verse 4 he says, "Abide in me and I in you." He talks about in verse 6, "If you do not abide in me, he's cast out." In verse 7, he says, "If you abide in me, and my words abide in you." So he switches it from "you abide in me, and me in you," to "you abide in me, and my words abide in you." So how does the Son abide in us? When his word is in us, when his truth is in us. And again, I don't know anyone who makes the claim that Jesus, the Son of God, literally, bodily indwells in. But the Bible teaches that he abides in us. In Ephesians chapter 4, or chapter 3 rather, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17, it says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. How does he dwell in our hearts? Through faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God, Romans 10, 17. So the Father dwells in us, we dwell in the Father, the Son dwells in us, and we dwell in the Son. And the Bible teaches the same thing about the Spirit. The Spirit dwells in us, and we dwell in the Spirit. If you go to Romans chapter 8, Romans chapter 8, this would be one place where the New Testament teaches about the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. In Romans chapter 8, verse 9, it says, "But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." So, we dwell in the Spirit. The Spirit dwells in us. You back up to chapter 8, verse 1, and he explains how this happens. "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. What is it to walk according to the Spirit? So walk by the gospel. Walk by that which the Holy Spirit has revealed, that truth that we have, the New Testament. That is to walk by the Spirit. Verse 2. For the law of Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. We walk according to the Spirit. We separate ourselves from the law of the flesh, from the sinfulness of the flesh, from wickedness and unrighteousness, when we follow the law of the Spirit. And when we do that, He goes on in the chapter and says that the Spirit dwells in us and we dwell in the Spirit. Let's put a finer point on this here. What is it to receive someone? We talk about, people sometimes talk about, well, I receive the Spirit. And what they mean is the Holy Spirit has come and bodily indwelt me. But let's just notice what the Bible talks about, how it describes receiving God, receiving the Spirit. You go to Matthew chapter 10, verse 40. Matthew chapter 10, verse 40. He who receives you receives me. And he who receives me receives him who sent me. So the apostles being sent out, Jesus says, you go out and you teach people and they receive you. That means they've received me. And if they've received me, that means they've received the Father. So you see how that works? Receive the apostles, that means you receive Christ, it means you've received God. In 3 John, you have the apostle writing to a church here, and 3 John verse 9 in particular, he makes mention of this. 3 John verse 9, I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them, does not receive us. You see that? Diotrephes does not want to have that writing from John. Whatever teaching, whatever instruction, whatever admonition or rebuke he had in there, he did not want to receive that. Now, that means he rejected John and his teaching. But if he had received the teaching, if he had accepted that teaching, then the opposite would be true. He would have received John. You see how John says, I wrote a letter and he wouldn't receive me? He wrote the letter, which was teaching, and he rejected it. That meant he rejected John. But if he had received that teaching, if he'd accepted it, he would have accepted the apostle. Now what about receiving Christ in Colossians chapter 2? Colossians chapter 2, notice verse 6 here. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him. So they've said, he's saying, you at Colossae, you've received Christ Jesus. You back up to chapter 1, verse 3. Colossians 1, verse 3. We give thanks to God the Father, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Since we heard of your faith in Christ and of your love for all the saints, because of the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, of which you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel. You see, they received the gospel. That's why he later says you received Christ. So walk in Him. He's saying walk in the truth. Walk in that which has been revealed to you. That's what it is to receive Christ. So we get to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, and notice verse 2 here. As people will read this sometimes, and that influence maybe of the world gets to them, that denominational doctrine takes over their thinking. But just understand, it's just as plain and simple as receiving Christ. Galatians chapter 3, verse 2, this only I want to learn from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? And what Paul is simply saying to those at Galatia is, now did you receive the Holy Spirit? Did you receive truth through the law? Is that how you came to learn about Christ and about salvation, about redemption and heaven and all of that? Is that how you came to hear about it? Or did you hear about it through faith? And he's talking about the faith, talking about that message that is given by the apostles and prophets. That's how you receive the Holy Spirit. When you receive His truth, you accept that truth. Let's understand that that's how the Holy Spirit works, is through His Word. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17, where he's talking about the armor of God, he refers to the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. So the Holy Spirit uses an instrument to do His work. It's sort of like this. You know, Jimmy shattered the glass. Well, the baseball shattered the glass. Jimmy shattered the glass with the baseball. Right? Jimmy did it. No, Mom, the baseball did it. Well, what Mom would go, okay, I'll accept that. No, you threw the ball through the glass. See how that works? So, think about this. God saved 8 souls. 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2, notice verses 4 and 5 here. For if God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell, delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment, and did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of 8 people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. So God saved 8 people, including Noah. But 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 20 says, who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is 8 souls, were saved through water. Now wait a minute. The Bible says those 8 souls were saved by God. But wait, it said they were saved by water. Now, are we going to put those two in contradiction with each other? Are we going to say there's an issue with the Bible here? No, we're going to say that God saved 8 souls through water. So when we talk about, when the Bible talks about the work of the Holy Spirit, we understand that does not lead to the conclusion that the Holy Spirit is directly, bodily working on you or me or anybody else. The Holy Spirit can use a tool, an instrument, a device, if you will, a medium through which He works. God worked through water to save Noah and his family. We attribute that action to God, but we understand that water was involved. It wasn't like God took His hand and He held Noah and his family, or even put His hand under that ark. It was water under that ark. But God saved him through water. So let's look at some of these things in the New Testament. Now, I trust that you are familiar with several of these here, so we're not going to read all the passages. But remember, it talks about being born again in John chapter 3, verse 3. Jesus comes back and says, you're born of the water and the Spirit. You cannot see the kingdom of God. Well, you go over to 1 Peter chapter 1, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 22 and 23 says, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit, in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the Word of God which lives and abides forever. The Bible tells us we're born again by the Spirit, but it tells us that we're born again through the Word. Now, which is it? Right? Well, we're born again by the Spirit who uses the Word to bring about that new birth. Then again, we're convicted. Remember, Jesus said in John chapter 16, verses 7 and 8, that when the Holy Spirit comes, He will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. The Holy Spirit would convict people. When you go to Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 2, and tell me, is this the Holy Spirit convicting people? In Acts chapter 2, remember the Holy Spirit came upon the apostles. The apostles began to speak with other tongues, Acts 2 verse 4 says, as the Spirit gave them utterance. When you read down through here, we have a record of Peter's preaching on the day of Pentecost. You get down to verse 36, he says, "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" You see how the Holy Spirit guided the apostles to preach, and that preaching is what convicted them, what cut them to the heart? He used that sword of the Spirit to get to them. And so, yes, the Holy Spirit did it, but the Holy Spirit did it through the Word. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 11, it says, "And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." You're washed, you're cleansed by the Holy Spirit. But remember, we read just a few moments ago on John 15, verse 3. John 15, verse 3, "You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you." See how the Holy Spirit can use the word to cleanse us? Titus 3, 5 says that we're saved by the Holy Spirit. But you go over to James chapter 1, verse 21, it says we're saved by the word that is implanted in us. So the Bible tells us about the work of the Holy Spirit in all these different areas, how on one hand it's attributed to the Spirit, on another hand it's attributed to the Word of God. She's simply saying that the Holy Spirit uses the Word to do His work. And that's how He works today, through the Word of God. If you will, open up to the hymn 847. 847. Even though there's a lot of confusion about the Holy Spirit, the nature, the work of the Holy Spirit, the Bible provides clarity to us. There's no need for us to be confused about it. It reveals it to us when we can resist the world and all the confusion that's out there about the Holy Spirit and people who tell you about these experiences that they've had. I couldn't tell you how many times people told me these experiences, but they're all over the place with the experiences and how they happened and how they unfolded. It's just something that happened to them, and I can't explain it. I mean, there's things that people, they talk to themselves, and sometimes they'll attribute that to the Holy Spirit. It's confusion out there. And we don't filter the Word of God through our experiences. We don't say, "Well, this is what I felt," or "This is something that someone told me about," and then we try to fit the Word of God into that. We have to go to the Word of God as the standard and filter out our feelings, our passions, even our experiences. Because those are not the truth. The Word of God is the truth, and we need to stand upon it. You know, the Spirit was sent by the Savior to reveal the gospel to the world. That was His work, to teach us, to inform us about the Savior who died for us and how to live righteously for Him so that we can have a home in heaven. The divine Word is ours. We can take it and read it and understand it and live by it. And what He tells us is that we need to hear that Word. As Romans 10:17 says, "So then faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God." We need to listen to God's Word. When we listen to God's Word, we need to allow it to penetrate into our hearts, understanding that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God, and we are called upon to repent so that the times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, Acts 3, verse 19, so that we can be forgiven. We don't repent, we cannot be forgiven of our sins, and we have to confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, as Romans 10, 9 and 10 tells us about. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. It tells us we need to go a step beyond that, because there are some who will say, yes, we need to hear what the Bible says and believe about Jesus, and we need to confess Him, we need to repent of our sins, and they'll stop right there with the plan of salvation. and say, that's enough. That's all you ever need to do. The Bible tells us that if we're going to be born again, yes, it's through the Word. Yes, it is through the Holy Spirit. But it's very specific in when and where that takes place. In Romans 6, verse 3, or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ, were baptized into His death? Therefore, we were buried with Him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. We walk in newness of life when we are born again. And He's saying here that we do that in the waters of baptism. So we hear the Word of God, we believe that Word of God, we believe Jesus is the Christ, we repent of our sins, we confess Him unashamedly before men, and we're baptized. And that's when we are born again, and it's all the work of the Holy Spirit, because that is what He has revealed for us to do. If you're a child of God and you've fallen back into sin, the Holy Spirit has revealed that what you need to do, as in the case of Simon the sorcerer, is to repent and to pray to God for forgiveness. There are times when we need to publicly confess because our sin is open and known. We brought shame and reproach on the church, and we need to confess that. Let everybody know we are not living like that any longer. There are times where it's just between us and God, and we seek His mercy and His forgiveness. So if you wish to be cleansed by the Holy Spirit this morning, you wish to have the redemption of your soul, you wish to be sanctified and useful for the Master, then won't you submit to Him? If you need to come forward, please do so now while we stand and sing.